Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Well, thank you for the kind introduction. As a native Hoosier, I can say that it's good to be home, but this is also the first time I've given any talk like this where I can say that there's the added pressure that my mom is in the audience somewhere. So I'll try to do an extra good job. I'm here tonight because I belong to a group that has rather dubious historical origins. The early practitioners of this tradition often claim to have access to supernatural powers, and to possess knowledge that was only granted to the worthy. As a result, they often couch their messages in the form of cryptic allegorical parables in order to hide this knowledge from the uninitiated. Now, these early adherents were initially persecuted and marginalized before ultimately gaining acceptance in the wider world. And I am, of course, talking about my heritage as a chemist. I think some of you are expecting me to say something else, but actually, I have some slides. Let's see, we'll get those up. So historically, chemistry has its origins in alchemy. And alchemy is based on the premise that by exploring certain philosophical truths, things like reason and beauty, that you can actually gain information about how what we now call chemicals act. And vice versa, there was the assumption that by understanding how chemicals act, that you could learn about these higher philosophical truths. There we go. All right, good. And so there we go, alchemy and chemistry. And so some examples of this. So this is a picture of a woman named Maria Profetisma. She lived in the 3rd century in northern Africa. She was an alchemist. She made an important contribution to chemistry. She described the first apparatus for distillation. She also described how she could use that apparatus to extract gold from plants. Then there's Jabir ibn Hayyan. He was an Arab alchemist in the 8th century. He described the discovery of citric acid. He also made the first descriptions of crystallization of compounds. He also made the first description of how you could synthesize scorpions from inanimate materials. Roger Bacon was an English alchemist in the 13th century. He described the first Western formula for gunpowder and also the first Western formula for turning lead into gold. And then finally, Paracelsus, who is the father of modern toxicology. He made great contributions to medicine and based most of his investigations on astrology, the idea that the motions of the planets influenced the bodily humors. You know, it may seem rather strange that something like chemistry grew up alongside something like alchemy until you realize that our mental image of a chemist is that of a person who wears a funny coat and mixes chemicals in a strange container. And our popular conception of an alchemist is also that of a person who wears a funny coat and mixes things in a strange container. So it took hundreds of years for chemistry to disentangle itself from the spurious influences of alchemy. Now, I am also a Christian, and the historical narrative of Christianity is eerily similar to that of chemistry. Historically speaking, religion has struggled to disentangle itself from the influences on the one hand, mythology, and on the other hand, of superstition. Now, mythology is the invention of fictional stories in order to explain physical phenomena that we cannot otherwise explain. So things like if you see someone get struck down with a thunderbolt, then you invent a bearded, wrathful deity who rides around on clouds and throws thunderbolts at people. Superstition is the belief that natural events can cause other natural events without any cause that can be attributed to reason or that runs contrary to observation. So here the idea is superstition tells you that if you break a mirror, you'll have 7 years of bad luck. Now, just as it would be a mistake to conflate alchemy and chemistry, so it would be a mistake to equate mythology and superstition with religion. Because historically speaking, reason and experimentation have been key tools by which we have been able to expunge things like mythology and superstition from religious belief and practice. So, for example, we can do experiments in order to explain thunderbolts without having to invoke wrathful deities. And we can do experiments to see, well, if somebody does break a mirror, do they actually have 7 years of bad luck? If they break a hand mirror, is it less? You know, only 6 months. How does the amount of bad luck scale with the size of the mirror? So we can use those things. But the question then becomes that in applying the scalpel of reason to religious faith, is there anything left? You know, is there a such thing as reasonable faith, or is it that we apply the scalpel of reason and everything just turns out to be irrational mythology and superstition? And I would contend that, yes, unequivocally, there is a such thing as a reasonable faith in God. I think it is absolutely reasonable to look at the universe, at the order of the universe, at the diversity of creation, at the intricacy with which it operates, and to wonder or to contemplate who or what might have made it that way. And at the same time, it's also reasonable to suspect that that who or what also might play some role in defining what our purpose is for existing. I think the thing that would be unreasonable would be to assert that the only reasonable position is to say that, well, based on the evidence, the universe must be a book without an author or a car without a driver. The evidence, I think, clearly allows for both possibilities. But these questions about whether God exists and what he or she might look like are questions that you, practically speaking, can't remain undecided about. Because life forces you to make choices about these things. So if I was to say that I am not sure if Jesus Christ is the Son of God, but at the same time I don't pray or go to church or do any of the things that Jesus taught me to do, I would say that while I just told you I'm not sure, I clearly am sure, because by my actions I've placed a fairly strong wager that says that I am pretty sure that what Jesus said about himself isn't true. And so with these either-or decisions, these choices that we have to make, even though the evidence is incomplete, how do we make them in the light of incomplete evidence? And the answer is that we use faith. We use faith. It might be faith in God. It might be faith in something else. It might be faith in some principle. It might be faith in a person. It might be faith in yourself. But we always use faith because faith is the way that we make decisions in the light of incomplete evidence. To put it in one way, faith is the thing that turns ideas into actions. Because as a human being, I need truth that has the power to change not just my mind, not just my ideas, but to change the way that I behave. Because, you know, I have a lot of moral maxims that I believe to be true. You know, nice things like do unto others as you would have others do unto you, turn the other cheek, always tell the truth. And I'm constantly disappointed by my inability to live up to those principles. Take, for example, prayer. So I would say certainly that prayer is important. It's a very important thing. Email, on the other hand, not so important. But if you asked me how many times a day I pray versus how many times a day I check my email, I would refuse to answer your question because the answer is embarrassing. See, what I need is not just something that changes the way that I think, not something that just convinces me, oh, it's a good thing to pray. I need something that actually motivates me to pray. See, what I believe, because whether I believe a maxim is true or not, it is only when I place faith in that maxim that it actually leads to action. So faith is the thing that leads me to action. But how does this happen? Why do some truths change me while others leave me unmoved? You know, and this question is crucial to me because I find that in practice, I actually need truth to change not just my behavior, but me, myself. Let me tell you why this is. So when I was growing up in Indianapolis, I was going to North Central High School. Go Panthers. Anybody? No. Okay. So anyway, I was going to high school, and in high school, I was a geek. Now, I know this is shocking to you. You're probably thinking quantum chemistry professor at MIT, and you were a geek in high school? Get out of town. But it's unfortunately true. I was tall and scrawny. I was socially awkward, and I was too smart for my own good. But rather than embracing my inner geek, what I really, really wanted in my heart of hearts was to be cool. I wanted to be popular. And it didn't make me a very good person. It caused me to shun all the people that I perceived to be lower on the social ladder than I was. You know, all the other people who didn't have the money to buy all the right clothes or all the other members of the chemistry Olympiad team, who in my opinion were far nerdier than I was. And I've encountered this same scenario time and again in my life. You know, I want things. I want good grades. I want success in my career. I want fame. I want wealth. And I know that none of these things are going to make me a good person. And in fact, I even suspect that none of them are going to make me a particularly happy person. But I still want them. Because the problem isn't with high school or with academia or with other people. The problem is me. The things that I want and the way I go about it. And no matter how hard I work, that's not a problem I'm going to be able to change because I am the problem. And you see, I don't just need to learn truth. I don't need to just find out right from wrong or know how many bones there are in the human body. What I need is truth that is alive, that can change who I am. And faith can do this. I found that faith and sort of a watchmaker God isn't enough, because if God just set the universe in motion and then hung out a sign that says, be back in 25 billion years, well, then I'm stuck. He's not going to help me. Whoever I am is whoever I am. And most religions are actually even worse on this account, because they tie our acceptance by God to our ability to accomplish a certain set of tasks or to live by a set of rules. It's only in Christianity that God provides the means for us to change who we are. See, in Christianity, what we believe is that when we place our faith in Christ, then the person of Jesus, who was raised from the dead, comes to live in us. And fundamentally, what I believe in is I believe in the power of Jesus to change me, to change who I am. Now, is this a reasonable faith? I think so, because in practice, I, as much as possible, try to base my decisions based on reason and experiment. But as with, I think, almost everyone, the motivations for my decisions come from faith. And within this Christian faith, I find a tremendous motivation for discovery in science, as well as something that sits very well in harmony with the scientific hermeneutic. So I'm looking forward to having a discussion about this, and thanks for your attention.
All right, thank you very much, Troy, and thanks for this opportunity to be a participant in this. I feel a bit like the, I guess, anti-proverbial lion being thrown to the Christians. And we sort of know how that turned out for the lions, right? I once went to a debate, and I appreciate this is not a debate, but I went to a debate by Philip Johnson at the University of Colorado Boulder. Some of you may know that he wrote this book, Darwin on Trial, in which some poor local biologist was brought up on the stage to deal with Professor Johnson. And what was very clear as a member of the audience at that time was just how well-practiced Johnson was at this, how many times he had done this. And I know Troy was nervous coming up here, but I know he's also done this a few times, and I haven't. So it's a little bit of trepidation that I feel, a little bit of wondering what I've walked into here. But anyway, the biologist, by the way, in Boulder was fuming mad at the end because he knew he had the facts on his side, but he just wasn't practiced at getting them out well enough. So anyway, in the spirit of debate here, the question is faith in God reasonable? And some of you of a certain age will maybe get this little bit of a joke, which is, well, it depends on the meaning of in, doesn't it? So the idea is, look, you know, faith in God could mean many things here. It could mean faith in the existence of God. And Troy's already told us that he's no watchmaker, believer in a watchmaker God, somebody who just started it all up and wound it up and set back. So I take it that it's not just in the existence of God that he's concerned, or that this debate is, or discussion is concerned with, but actually some of the more personal testimonial that Troy gives is about access to God, right? So is God accessible or inaccessible, we might say? And there I think there are some really challenging questions for anybody who wants to claim that they can have this kind of reasoned relationship with something that about which there's at least a lot of controversy. So carrying on with what do we mean by the words in this question, I'm going to jump to the back and bring up this word reasonable. And that's kind of an odd term, because it's not a term that comes up in my field, such as cognitive science, right? What does come up is the question of rational, and perhaps that's what's meant here. Is it rational? And that might mean a couple of different things. If you go to the dictionary, it'll tell you that reasonable means fair and sensible, right? Instead of a person or typically. So, yeah, I know lots of fair and sensible people who believe in God, so have faith in God. And so if reasonability is doing what reasonable people do, then sure, it's a reasonable thing. You're going to find lots of supporters around you. But I think what's wanted here is something more than that, right? We want more than lots of perfectly nice believers. We might call that the banality of faith in a certain way, right? What's wanted here is again this more kind of direct personal knowledge of some higher being. Now, if you go back to the dictionary, the second thing that it says there is that there's an archaic meaning of reasonable to mean able to think, understand, or form judgments by a logical process. And in some ways, this feels like a bit of a step into an archaic debate, right? There's the terms of the discussion here are terms that have been set a very long time ago, right? And this discussion has been going on for a very long time. And over the years, from my perspective, one could argue that faith and religion has always been playing a sort of rear guard action, right? There have been claims made which then turn out to be incorrect. And we'll come to some examples of that in a moment. So one question to ask here was, well, when would faith be unreasonable? Right? And I'm going to tell a little anecdote. So Tim mentioned that when I was 8 years old, I moved to the Caribbean with my family. And when I was 9 years old, we were spending some time in the Cayman Islands, on the island of Grand Cayman. And I was attending an evangelical school. And there was a hurricane bearing down on the Cayman Islands. So the school was called in, and we all prayed that this thing would not hit us. Well, it didn't. It veered north and went over Cuba instead. So we were all called back in to give thanks for this miraculous change of course of hurricanes. Actually, I don't think it's so miraculous. Hurricanes wobble all over the place all the time. But what really shocked me, even at the age of 9, was that added to that prayer was a thanks for sending the hurricane to go hit those godless communists in Cuba. All right? Now, I take it that we would all agree that this is unreasonable faith, right? This is not fair. Or just. And I think that also highlights a lot of problems that people have when trying to think about what counts as unreasonable faith. There seem to be far too many people who want to use their faith as an excuse to sort of accept the harm that's done to others, or even to cause harm to them. And that is, of course, a big worry for anybody who wants to claim that faith is reasonable. So what about reasonability as rationality? And I think a big thing that's motivating a lot of this discussion, and in fact, if you go to the Veritas website, you will find Troy himself has a pamphlet on this, on certainty, right? It's the quest for certainty. And one thing that Troy and I agree on is that science doesn't deliver certainty. There are always boundaries of uncertainty. We're pretty darn sure that the Earth is not the center of the universe at this point, right? But as scientists, we also know what evidence would make us change our mind about that. Right? We think it's exceedingly unlikely we're going to discover that evidence, but we have standards for what that evidence would be, right? And so we understand that you can never be 100% certain because you never know what's around the next corner. And that's part of the fun of doing science, right? Your ideas can just be blown out of the water by the next thing you find. But to come back to the question is when is faith in God irrational or unreasonable? I think again, to repeat the question I gave a moment ago, the better question is, well, what would you accept as evidence against it? Because if nothing would convince you otherwise, right, then we have nothing, we have no basis for a reasonable discussion at that point, it seems to me. Right? So Troy told us a nice allegory about chemistry coming from alchemy and religion similarly coming from mythology and superstition by the application of reason. And my question, again, is does this analogy really work? Because chemistry has standards. We know, right, why we believe the things that chemists tell us over the things that alchemists tell us. Right? So how can we say the same thing about religion? What are the standards of evidence here? And when it comes to his quip about email versus prayer, I think, well, I know why you answer email, because you get responses, right? Prayer seems a lot more nebulous in this way. And I don't doubt the benefits for those who do it, but I wonder whether those benefits might come from, say, just as well from meditating, or in my case, going for a long bike ride. Right, that's what I like to do. So if you are going to claim some direct reasonable knowledge, right, access, not just existence, but access of some deity, then you have to say where this is coming from. It can come from an internal feeling, but there are people all over the place with you know, claiming that they have these feelings. Or you can turn to scripture. And I'm going to quote Troy from his pamphlet on certainty, where he says, as a Christian, I believe that the Bible is true and false from error. But then he immediately says, but of course it requires interpretation, right? Because we know that there are things that are on the surface, two different creation stories at the beginning of Genesis, for instance. Right, so you've got to do some interpretive work. And once you start down that path of interpretive work, what are the standards, right? Looks like anything goes, perhaps, unless somebody can tell me what the standards are. And so, what should we say? Troy himself, in his booklet, talks about a statement from the Bible that maggots come from cornmeal. And he says, well, in a sense, they do. Go home and do the experiment. Well, I've done the experiment. No maggots, right? It's only if you add something to the maggots or something gets in there besides the cornmeal that you will get the, if you add something to the cornmeal that you will get the maggots, right? So I think I'm running into the last couple of minutes here. I think the big question for anybody, and Troy hinted at this, who wants to claim a kind of personal relationship with a deity is, what is this God like? And how would we adjudicate different claims about what that God is like? And I've already hinted at the difficulty of interpreting passages from any particular scripture. You can pick on the Bible because that's the context that we're in here, but I think it applies to any kind of scriptural basis. And I can't really do much better than quote those great philosophers, the crash test dummies. Was that a parable or a very subtle joke? So who's God? I think it's undecidable. I think the quest for certainty is perhaps a false quest. Science doesn't fully provide it, but neither does religion as I see it practiced. I just don't know what the standards are for evidence. So with that, let's open up the discussion.
All right, Troy, Colin, we have time for a little bit of discussion, so forget about these people out here. We're in the faculty club, just the three of us, talking. We're going to honestly share what we think about some of these things. Let's start, as philosophers like to do, and foundational scientists too, I suppose, with questions about foundations. We're asking a question about reasonableness. So is there a final court of appeal when it comes to reasonableness for anything? Is it science? If it's not science, then where does science derive its intellectual authority from? So,
yeah, I mean, I talked first. I guess I'll answer this one. But, you know, I think, you pointed out this sort of tension that we have in terms of the fact that reasonableness is in the title, but are we talking about reason and reasonableness in terms of rationality or reasonableness in terms of, well, just being, you know, affable and going along? You know, and I think it's an intentional play on words, of course, where, you know, you want it to be something of both to some extent. Because I think that, you know, in terms of the role that rationality plays as something that adjudicates, you know, I think that, you know, in terms of trying to cut rationality, one of the reasons that it succeeds and one of the reasons that science succeeds is because, as was pointed out, you know, that we have a means for adjudicating evidence and discussing these things. And so in cases where science is useful, and you can gather the kind of scientific evidence you want for a proposition, then I think science is a great example of the success of rationalism in terms of the propagation of ideas across different cultures and different climates and different times. That being said, the scientific approach doesn't always work. There are plenty of phenomena for which, you know, the scientific, you know, hypothesis testing doesn't really apply very well. You know, to like the liberal arts, for example, you know, testing which aria is more beautiful doesn't really work. And so you have to have some other set of standards that supplement that. You know, there are things that, you know, okay, well, this is not beautiful because it really was, you know, composed by a three-year-old, so this is not very good. But, you know, so there's some level of
unless that was Mozart.
Unless it was Mozart. Yeah, so there are some objective standards that you could agree on, but then beyond that, there are subjective standards that then it does lead to the question of, well, you know, who's right when we disagree about, you know, which one of these things is the most beautiful or along those things. And I think that in terms of the role of reason there, the thing that we have to judge is, okay, well, you know, there's always going to be, in lots of things, there are going to be gaps in arguments that you can make solely based on reason and evidence. And then you have to judge, okay, well, how willing am I in order to, you know, to bridge that gap with some argument that maybe makes sense to me but might not be justifiable in a way that I can adjudicate and say, I must be right and you must be wrong.
So science is not foundational to reasonableness in every domain.
I would not say so.
So we've got different standards in different domains.
I often discuss the trend of every field to want to attach science to its name as if that's somehow a beneficent title.
The dean gives us more money if we do that.
Yeah,
there you go, yeah. Okay, Colin, why don't you have a shot at
this? The noetic sciences, here we are. Well, so I think the proper naturalistic attitude towards things like beauty is to say first, well, let's figure out why people make the judgments that they do. And that is a very complicated story. I'm suspicious of anybody who says, I know already that nothing that you discover here will help me understand why people make the judgments that they do. You can't make that decision until you've done the kind of research that I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Now, when we get to the end and we find out, well, people make these judgments because, let's say, symmetry is more pleasing than asymmetry, or because a certain degree of complexity is more pleasing than something that's just a straight line and very plain, right? But too much complexity, that's chaotic. We don't like that either, right? I think at the end of it, there might still be a question where one says, well, so why do humans, or do we, or does this culture, because some of these things are very culturally relative, focus on these things as beauty rather than those other things? And there, again, there's going to be another set of naturalistic questions naturally raised. You know, some people want to tell you because there are evolutionary benefits to preferring symmetry. I think that's simplistic, but it's the kind of thing one might do. They might tell you that it's a kind of marker of group membership. It takes a long time to learn what the people around you think is worthwhile, and so that you share those preferences is a very costly signal, to use a biological concept, of your membership in that group, and that has all kinds of group benefits as well, and the culture becomes self-perpetuating in this way. Now, if you still hold out and say, but look, I still want to know what makes something normatively good rather than bad, right? There, I think, you can insist that there's an unanswered question, but there you might be just insisting, like the alchemist might have insisted, that chemistry didn't answer the questions they started with, right? At a certain point, we just decide, you know what, those questions were confused or mistaken. And I, of course, can't predict exactly how that's going to turn out, because science will take its own course on these things, and our better understanding of it will go. In the meantime, there's plenty of work for people in the liberal arts and humanities to be producing things of beauty, trying to analyze and understand things of beauty. I'm reminded of the joke from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, where the philosophers come and complain that the computer is going to put them out of work by solving the problem of the meaning of life, right? And the computer responds, don't worry, you won't understand the answer when you get it anyway, so there'll still be plenty to talk about, right? So I don't see the end of the humanities anytime soon. It doesn't worry me that these kinds of more naturalized scientific investigations go along. So to the foundational question about, you know, reason being foundational, yes, it is reason in the sense of logical consistency, following certain standards of evidence, which themselves are debatable. The standards of evidence in animal behavior might be really different from they are in particle physics, right? But there is a community effort to hold people to account and standards by which people understand whether or not they're going to be allowed to make certain claims. And that way, reason does seem to me to be foundational to science. And as I said in my set piece, I'm less clear what the rules are when it comes to theological.
Okay, well, let's make that transition, since I did want to bridge that gap. So we're thinking about reasonableness in general, and now in application to religious belief and faith. If reasonableness, maybe I'll start with you, Colin, if reasonableness ultimately comes down to our entrenched ways of doing things within communities of inquiry, religious belief is extremely prevalent among human beings. It's enough so that biologists speculate whether there could be adaptive explanations for the fact that we have a propensity towards religious belief. Of course, there's widespread disagreement about the details, famously. But that there is a reality beyond nature is something that almost all human beings that have lived on the face of the planet have thought. Something, or at any rate, that there's an aspect to reality, even if it's not beyond nature, that's not empirical. So would that suggest that there's something, at least of a very vaguely religious sort, that's sort of built into our way of thinking about rationality, or what? And then just use that as a segue into what role should reason play for anyone, a person who's trying to be a conscientious, reasonable inquirer when it comes to religious belief?
Yeah, so, I mean, let me take the last part first, because I think that there are all sorts of ways to make your way in the world, and there are clearly certain kinds of things that can be done within the structure of religion that are very hard to do outside that structure. Mm-hmm. It's not to say that they can't be done, they're just harder to do. And one has to decide where to put one's efforts, and it may just be easier to go along, you know, with a certain set of beliefs, surrounded by other people with similar beliefs, provides a kind of structure where you can do other productive things without having to sort of have this angst-filled, what's my role in the universe question impinging on you all the time. But the question of whether or not there's, at the end of the day, we should take the fact that this is a very widespread human phenomenon as evidence for something, I think is not as straightforward as that question might make it seem, mm-hmm. and you probably knew that when you asked it, right? So one can think of all sorts of ways in which believing certain kinds of not-quite-truths or falsehoods actually does prevent you from going off and doing things that would otherwise be harmful. There are lots of things that humans have practiced as cultures which are indicative of certain kinds of attitudes toward the world, which may in fact have, this is sort of to take the evolutionary perspective, may in fact have their success because of the kinds of group cohesion and so on that they foster. I think as we pursue the kind of naturalistic pursuit that I was talking about earlier, we can begin to disentangle, and perhaps this is to go even further, to sort of disentangle religion from superstition. Which bits of this are really doing the work here, right? So group identification, community, supporting others, those are all very valuable things. And insofar as that was constrained by belief in a higher power, because people thought that without that they wouldn't be, their behavior wouldn't be constrained, you can see why that belief would also play a very functional role. And to sort of tell another anecdote, I used to teach at Texas A&M, and I once had a student, I was actually the first faculty advisor for the atheist and agnostic student group there, but I had a student who found out about that and said, well, if you're not religious, what stops you from just raping and killing and stealing? As if that was the only constraint on his behavior, right? And I think that's such a fundamental misunderstanding of what happens when you detach the, from my point of view, mythology of a supernatural being from the other aspects of thinking rightly about how to treat others and all the rest of it. The application of reason to those questions, right? That I see this removal of the deity is sort of a continuation of the process that you were outlining.
All right, so Troy, you sort of hinted at a picture on which, you know, science is an authority in certain domains. When we want to understand general processes in nature, perhaps, science has developed methods that we should respect, but there might be other areas of inquiry, aesthetics, beauty, human value, that science really doesn't speak directly to, and in these areas, different standards apply. Are you going to say the same thing about religion? Does it have its own set of rules?
Well,
or
I don't want to mischaracterize what I'm trying to say. I'm saying that there are places where scientific evidence is very compelling, and there are places where scientific evidence is not very compelling. So that's really my fundamental point. There is not any sort of evaluative statement of saying, oh, different standards should apply here versus not applying here. I'm just saying that if you just want to use scientific evidence in some areas, It does not seem very compelling to me by itself. Now, sort of the taking science in again is natural science is my sort of discipline. Sure. In terms of you know, getting back to the sort of standards and the community standards for evidence and things, I do think that this is one of the fundamental reasons for the institutions of religion, which is that they are communities because when we talk about interpreting scripture, you know, interpretation of scripture is not done in a vacuum. Interpretation of scripture is done in community with other people. It's in terms of how it's lived out and how it's practiced and in discussion and in disputation amongst other people. And so to some extent, religion exists in order to sort of self-correct errors that, you know, the Lone Ranger person who has this really wacky interpretation of scripture and goes off and does this thing will sort of get reeled back in by the fact that, okay, everybody's like, that's maybe a little bit crazy. Don't go that way. And, you know, you might argue that that's really, okay, well, this is just, you know, wanting to socially belong or something like this, but there is a certain intellectual value to the fact that you have other people who are struggling through interpreting this, because the things that we derive from scripture are not solely intellectual content. The sort of interpretation of scripture leads not just to an intellectual framework, but also to a lived out framework for life. And so it's not something that I think thrives very well in the sort of thing that, well, which is, you know, the scholarly model, which is, you know, the single scholar in a room reading and deciphering. And then in terms of the reason as a basis for faith, I mean, the one thing I would say in terms of faith is that, you know, for anyone in the audience, you know, don't ever join any faith that asks you to controvert your reason or to do something that you think does not make sense or tells you to not ask questions about it, because that is not healthy. So in terms of the primacy of reason, I would certainly make that statement that if you ever feel you're being drawn into something like that, that should be a huge warning flag that says, okay, maybe this isn't the right, you know, this is asking me to sort of deny one of my mental faculties that I think is very important.
Okay. I mean, I would just add, I think, to this statement that there are communities in which these interpretations get worked out and there are standards within those communities. A striking fact from the outside of it is that those communities seem to fission more often than they fusion, right? And I'm not saying science is monolithic, because clearly there's difference of opinion in different camps within science too, but there does seem to be more convergence in the end. And so I think there's a real question there about what is it about the standards of evidence and reason in science that leads to that kind of convergence? What is it about the standards of interpretation in religion that seems to lead to a thousand sects, right? You know, lampooned in movies like The Life of Brian.
Yeah. Should I go first or should he?
You're just the moderator.
Well, you're actually anticipating.
I'll openly confess that I would view this as one of the profound frustrations that many Christians have with Christianity. That, you know, we intend to be unified.
We intend to be together.
And why are we like this? What is going on? Why do we have all of these churches that split over things that you look back at and you're like, that seems so petty that we would just, you know, break a church into two churches because of that? Really? And I think this really is something that And, you know, as a Christian, I would, you know, relate this back to the fact that I have high moral standards that I don't seem to be able to live up to very well.
But how broad is your theology here? So I'm not sure if he's still there, but the Archbishop of York in the UK, as of about 15 years ago, actually did not believe in the divinity of Jesus, right? He thought Jesus was just an ordinary man. Apparently that's tolerable within the Anglican Church. I don't think it's tolerable in certain other Christian churches.
Yeah, the joke that I heard is that in the Anglican Church, they believe in at most one God.
Right.
Might be treading on thin ice there.
That was a joke that an Anglican told me. He said, that's what we believe. But it's not my joke.
Right, right.
So, I think there certainly are, there are the petty things, and then there are the more substantial things where you say, well, you know, at what point does this become heresy or heterodoxy that is really not true? And I think, you know, there are cases of things, you know, like that where I'd say, well, you know, that for me at least, and for, you know, people within my, you know, my realm of Christianity, my part of Christianity would say, well, you know, that particular statement would be you know, there are certain things where I can say, okay, this is petty. It probably we still sort of believe the same thing. And then there are things like, okay, well, Jesus is not the Son of God. Just a man. I'd say that's
okay.
And,
well, know. this will segue for me into the next question I wanted to ask, because we don't have to focus on extremely narrow, very highly sectarian versions of Christianity or any religion, but broadly traditional Christianity, broadly traditional Islam, broadly traditional Buddhism and other forms of religious belief do make competing claims with other religions, and these disagreements are entrenched. And so this is a big issue people raise. What does a reasonable person do in the face of entrenched deep disagreement where it's not, you know, petty squabbling?
Yeah.
And both in the context of religion, but then can we learn anything from how disagreement is dealt with in the sciences? So if you want to spin your thoughts that way.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I would agree with the statement that in the sciences there is typically a convergence towards consensus, though not always. I would also say that that convergence, you know, from a person who's a behind-the-scenes scientist, that process is not nearly as neat as I think it is perhaps publicly perceived to be. It is often a very messy, you know, messy process of coming to agreement. And sometimes agreement isn't reached. You know, I'll have a paper that I submit, and sometimes three of the four referees will agree with me, but one will absolutely not agree with me, given the exact same set of evidence and the exact same presentation. They'll say, no, I don't think this is right. This paper's wrong. So they will tell me in no uncertain terms, and sometimes not friendly terms, that they think it's wrong. I think we should also say that, you know, the messiness of disagreements, that, you know, there certainly are lots of messy and even bloody disagreements between religious traditions, I think is really a reflection of the fact that these are, you know, even more tightly, you know, I really believe my scientific paper, but I, you know, I'm willing to hold it, you know, with an open hand and say, well, you know, it might be wrong. I think that the important thing in terms of coming to a dialogue between different faiths is the openness to the idea that you might be wrong. And I think that, you know, when you close up and you say, well, there's no way that I could possibly be wrong, then you lead to these, you know, it leads to these divisions and sort of conflict that, you know, leads to sort of divergence of things. Now, in terms of adjudicating, well, I might be wrong and an imam might be wrong, and which one of us actually is wrong, I think that's really very difficult. I don't think, unique to religion. I think that's fairly common amongst academic disciplines. Maybe you would disagree with that, but...
Well, again, I would come back to what the standards for resolving these disputes is. So, yes, different academic disciplines are more or less contentious, and there are lots of reasons why, let's say, there's less unity in anthropology as a social science than there is in physics as a natural science. But again, even within the more contentious disciplines, people can usually say, well, if you show me this, I will change my mind. Now, again, looking currently from the outside at the different religious traditions, I'm not sure. I mean, I know people get converted. People do convert. People fall in and out of faith as well. But I'm not sure quite whether there's any prior standard by which, you know, you would say, okay, you got me, I'm a Buddhist, mm-hmm. right? Or I'm converting to Islam. What would convince you, right, that everything that you take to be rock solid in your faith is in fact wrong? Do you really approach that with a kind of open book, as you said you do when you submit your papers mm-hmm. to the journals?
Yeah, it's certainly, I will say that there is certainly an extra challenge there, which I think doesn't actually have to do so much with reason as so much as the fact that these are things that are lived out, so that I've lived however many years as a Christian and invested so much time and energy in this that, you know, I've got a certain investment in this that, you know, taking it all back implies that, you know, some of that investment was wasted. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that there is nothing that would ever cause me to do that. It just means that I'm going to be fairly conservative about what's going to make me say, okay, never mind, I'm actually... I can say that, you know, from my own experience, I definitely have a strong sense of the presence and existence of God, so I don't know that I would ever become atheist, but I could be convinced that some other theistic tradition is actually more correct. That is certainly possible. You know, I could, you know, it's hard to imagine since all of these things are based on a somewhat more fixed body of evidence than science, you know, it's hard to imagine more archaeological or historical or type information that would come along and say, oh, I get it now, okay, never mind, I'm changing my mind. But, you know, in the hypothetical world, you know, there are things that could cause me to say, oh, let me actually reevaluate these Christian ideas and say, well, you know, was Muhammad really the prophet of God? Or was, you know, Joseph Smith the prophet from God? Or, you know, is Buddha really the one who had the path to enlightenment and Jesus stole it from him? Or...
So, oh, go ahead.
I was going to throw the question, the same question towards you. What would cause you to change your sort of overall moral framework that doesn't involve deep reliance on any particular religious tradition that might, you could say, yeah, if this were to happen, I could potentially see myself at least be tempted, intellectually tempted, by some religious tradition in a way that I am not now?
So I think it's interesting that you used overall moral framework there, because I think that I try as much as possible to have the moral framework based on a kind of reasoned principles. And so that's a little harder to say what would make me think that I have a right to treat somebody differently just because they have brown eyes rather than blue eyes or something like that.
Okay, right? No, I wasn't suggesting, that wasn't my question.
But if it's religion, I come back to the, was that a parable or a very subtle joke? Certainly the deities that might be could be a whole lot more explicit than they have been, right? I'm not saying that giant skywriting would do it for me, but there are certainly some signs that would be very hard to make sense of without positing the existence of something that has the power to do anything, as I take it, the omnipotence of the deity is supposed to imply. Now,
of public observational evidence.
Yeah, right. So I'm bringing the standard of science back to this question, mm-hmm. right? So you show me that you can routinely violate the laws of physics, right? All right, okay. You know, you've got some. You know something I don't do. I don't know, and maybe there would be some. You know, my first inclination would be to say, well, let's see if we can find some way.
There must be another law of physics.
Well, there might be. Yeah, I think I can see a kind of sequence of attempting to sort of explain this in other terms where you would exhaust all avenues, right?
So it would need to be evidence of that sort.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And you never really sort of spelled out, what kind of evidence would cause you to. You said, well, I could imagine, but... So if the archaeologists, working in ancient Israel, if they agree, both Christian archaeologists and others, we've discovered a tomb, and herein lies the bones of Jesus of Nazareth.
Yeah, that's really just a question of, what would cause me to decide that Christianity was probably either in some sense flawed or not. It's not necessarily telling me, okay, well, now I would therefore decide that one of something else, it doesn't say, I was phrasing it more in a positive sense of saying, okay. what would cause me to question Christianity, but what would cause me to change my mind? Because what I was saying about the sort of conservativeness is things that cause me to question the validity of various, Christian doctrines and so forth would be unlikely in and of themselves to just push me over the edge there because of the sort of inertia argument there. But if there was a positive argument that said, okay, no, it's pushing you over the edge into the arms of something else, then I think there's more likelihood for me. So, it'd be historical evidence in favor of, in favor of some of the things that the Quran, for example, or mm-hmm. actually the Quran doesn't have any miracles, but in the other Muslim writings that say, okay, well, some of the things that the really, proof positive things that were fabled to have occurred there actually occurred. And I'd say, well, that's really pretty unusual.
All right. Well, we have just a few minutes before we're going to begin to take our questions from our audience, so we're going to have to be more concise than we professors are used to being. But just very quickly, a student had suggested I ask you, look, if you both are sort of settled, you've thought about your outlook on things for some time now, you must both be at least, 30 at this point? But imagine the poor 20-year-old sitting here, the undergraduate student who's really grappling with questions of competing religious and secular worldviews. What advice would you give them in a very concise way about how they should move forward?
What he said, don't be pressured into any group that wants you to give up on your reason. Now, of course, we're going to have some disagreement about what is reasonable.
Which groups will do that,
right.
Yes.
So I would just advise, talk to as many people as you can. Talk to people that you think have some difference of perspective in particular. Don't just go for one particular mindset.
Okay, Troy?
And I would echo that I think that talking with other people is a crucial aspect of resolving these questions. And I would also encourage you to talk about, I mean, I appreciate, what would I recommend? Is I would recommend asking about some of these more existential kinds of questions, even though they aren't the pragmatic questions of, how am I going to get an internship? How am I going to position myself for this job? And, what graduate school am I going to apply to? Because, from my perspective, many of my foundational philosophical belief systems were essentially set by the time I was 30. So, if I hadn't considered them before that, I might have lived the unreasoned and unexamined life and just sort of sailed along. So I would encourage you to, even though it seems maybe impractical, to spend the time discussing and figuring out what you believe and what you think about.
He was echoing a famous philosopher there way back in the beginning, in case you didn't catch that. If you took my introduction to philosophy, you'd know exactly what he was referencing. But that's fantastic. I think now is time for us to begin taking some questions from the floor. So some of you have been texting questions. We're going to have people coming over here to the podium, students, to pose our questions, and you'll both have an opportunity to reply as you like.
Hi, my name is Sam, and the question I have for you is, if we detach ourselves from a deity, how can we then explain our universal ability to have morals and believe in right and wrong?
I guess that's for me.
You first, anyway.
Well, I think, as I've said a couple of times this evening, there's a lot of ways to think about morality that don't necessarily attach you to the deity. And in fact, going back to another figure that hopefully gets covered in your intro to philosophy class, this is an old problem that Plato discussed, is God good because whatever God says makes it good or does makes it good, or is God held to some independent standard of goodness? And Plato argued that it had to be the latter. The first would make anything potentially good, and that, so if killing was something that God said you do, that would make it good, and that just seemed wrong to Plato. And I think you can think through this rationally as well and say, well, yeah, what fundamentally is morality about? It's about regard for others, not just yourself. And so once you have regard for others, questions automatically come up, well, which others, right? And what do you owe them? And those questions can be also addressed in a kind of a rational way. If I decide I'm only going to favor people with brown eyes and not people with blue eyes, well, first I'd be hurting myself, but that would seem morally arbitrary, right? That just seems like there's no possible reasonable justification for treating those two groups differently. And so I think we can reason our way through to a view that says, this is what's fair, this is what's just, these are our moral principles that don't depend on the sanctions or edicts of a deity.
Yeah, I would maybe nuance that question a little bit, because when I hear that question, there's two separate questions there. One is, how could you arrive at a moral code without God? Which I think I would totally agree with you that you can use reason and various philosophical points of view in order to arrive at perfectly reasonable standards of ethics that make you not a rapist or a murderer or any of those kinds of things. But there's the separate question of why do we even have these concepts of good and evil, right and wrong, because they're not from observation. Whatever I think of as good, it's not this. It's not what I've experienced in my life. I've experienced some mixture of good and bad and so forth, and I have this idea somewhere in my head that yet there's this good that I've never seen, but that, good moral rightness, and the question for me, is where does that come from? And I think using, there are evolutionary arguments here that maybe we were evolved to have moral codes. I'm highly leery of evolutionary arguments about these things, because you're making evolutionary arguments about our brains, that they were forced to think in a particular way, which means that you're making an evolutionary argument about the thing that made you come up with evolution to begin with. makes you sort of question the machine. If you start questioning the machine, then where do you go?
So with all due respect, I think there's a basic logical error in that response. Yes, not everything I see is good, but I nevertheless categorize some things into good and bad. Not everything I see is a donkey, but I nevertheless categorize things into donkeys and not donkeys. So there are features of these things which lead me to apply one judgment rather than the other. And then that gets back to the naturalistic question that I had before. So what are the features that drive...
Well, I would say it's different because the things that I see are actually mixtures of good and evil. It would be like saying there's a donkey and then there's like a proto-donkey. It looks kind of like a donkey, but is different.
I'm not sure I get the analogy, but your imagination may be better.
Because I'm basically saying that you know, it's not as if there's every action I can say, this action is good and this action is evil.
Right.
I would say that almost every action is some mixture of good and evil, of good and bad. Right. And I have some, you know, innate idea that there is some scale there, that there's an extreme good end that exists.
But again, I think, you know, just throwing mixtures at me doesn't really change the basic point. Every sample of water I encounter is actually a mixture of water with some other things. It just happens to be more H2O than anything else here.
So, yes, it's like absolute zero.
Yeah, and so I think I have the rational means to set up a scale or even a multidimensional space and say, okay, you know, here's an action. There's all sorts of features to it. Some of those features are relevant to its evaluation as somewhat good and not necessarily the best it could have been. And the task is, again, to try to get clear about what those features are. And that's, you know, this is a standard scientific, you might think cop-out, but I think it's actually the state that science is always in. There are things that have not yet been investigated thoroughly enough. Now, at the end, you say, well, I've got this sort of clear idea of the two extremes. But I think that we have that, again, with respect to substances that we deal with in ordinary life, right? We have the ideal of pure water, even if we've never encountered it.
All right, well, with hybrid donkeys and multivariate spaces, I think it's time to rein our professors back down to earth with another question.
My name is Tyler, and the question that I have, logical systems like geometry have assumptions that cannot be proved. For example, two parallels do not and will not ever cross. To what extent are those assumptions taken on faith? How is faith different from religious faith?
Is that for me again?
No, I think it should be either for us. Either of us. I can go first. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, I think, you know, there is certainly the statement that, you know, even in mathematics, you have to have axioms, you know, that you take as baseline. I'm going to take these axioms, and I'm going to see what comes of these. But I think there's a difference in terms of the way that you treat axioms versus the way that faith works, because axioms, it's really a supposition. You're saying, I'm going to suppose that this is true. It may or may not actually be true, but I'm going to suppose it is and see where that gets me. And that actually is one component of how reason and faith interact, which is you say, okay, well, if I want to think this is a reasonable thing to believe, I'm going to first suppose it's true and then see where it leads me. And if it leads me to think that people with brown eyes are better than people with blue eyes, I'm going to take that as evidence this is probably not a very good supposition. And so there are some things that you can learn from the ways that we use axiomatic proofs in geometry in terms of how you evaluate claims that might be more faith-based, but the actual intellectual engagement is different, because ultimately if you believe a faith claim, you actually are making a somewhat stronger claim about the truthfulness of that claim, as opposed to, you know, two lines being parallel, because if you're in parallel, because if you're in hyperbolic space, they're not parallel, they cross.
Yeah, I don't have much to add to that. I mean, obviously there are forms of geometry which don't accept that axiom. We investigate them as consistent set of axioms nonetheless, and we actually find out that they apply to relativistic space-time physics. So I don't think mathematics is the right model for thinking about this, and I think I just agree with what you said.
But just to follow, to kind of shore up the student's question a little bit, maybe it was the example chosen wasn't the ideal one, but the point still remains, does it not, that there are surely there have to be some foundational assumptions that we bring to bear to even engage in the activity we call science.
Certain
norms of evidence of a very general sort, certain logical axioms.
At a very broad level, if we say that, reason is our paragon of intellectual, we're saying, we believe our senses. That's one of our foundational things. I believe my eyes and my ears and my...
Other things being equal, simpler theories are more likely to be true?
That might be another one that we just say, believe, we're just going to take this, I think that is certainly, something that has to be considered is that in every field of inquiry, there are things that you just have to take on credit. I'm going to start with that and go. I think the idea that there is some system of knowledge where you don't have to assume anything or take anything on faith or on supposition or whatever you want to say it's called is false. I mean, everybody's got some...
So I think that practically one does take certain things without challenge in order to get anything done at all. That doesn't mean that even the things that seem the most fundamental aren't, at least within a scientific framework, questionable. So you might have thought it made no sense at all to say that some particle is in a superposition of two incompatible states. But, from a classical perspective, it can't have both of these properties. But quantum mechanics shows you how to manage that within a consistent mathematical framework. And in fact, you can't make sense of the results of the experiments without allowing those kinds of superpositions to take place. So the evidence actually drives us to accept something that reason itself balked at in the first place, right? Now, what about logic itself? Well, there's a whole bunch of Australian logicians who think that you can actually manage inconsistency, but now I'm off into being a professor again. The point is, though, which logic we want to use is just as much a choice given our particular aims of making sense of the empirical world as which geometry to use. And it would take a lot to convince us to give up, the law of non-contradiction, but as quantum mechanics again shows, you can manage certain things that look like contradictions initially and turn out not to be when you get more careful about it.
All right, let's take another question.
Hi, my name is Tina, and the question I have is, are faith in God and belief in evolution contradictory positions?
I think this is for Troy to begin.
I can give the short answer, which is no. And then I can give a longer answer, which...
be concise, right?
I'm supposed to be concise, so next question. I appreciated the way that question was worded because it asked if they are contradictory positions. And I think they are not contradictory positions. There are some Christians who would disagree with me on that. And this, again, is based on the idea of the interpretation of Scripture, that some Christians interpret the Scripture in a particular fashion that says that evolution cannot have happened. Other Christians interpret in a way that says that it could have happened, and that, based on scientific evidence and, holistically looking at Scripture, it suggests a God who actually used evolution, and that the creation account is intended more as an origin story of us noting that we are created by God, but not giving a scientific account of it. And so asking if it is contradictory allows me to say, I don't have to endorse either of those positions, because all I have to say is it necessarily contradictory? Well, clearly no, because there's some people for whom it is not contradictory.
The way you went at it, if I could, just to follow up, and then I do want to hear Colin speak to this. I can imagine someone like Colin saying, this is a good test question for understanding the role of reason in religion. Granted, a Christian may think she has a form of evidence from Scripture that maybe looks in tension with evolution. Will she allow that scientific evidence at least should have some weight in how she assesses what she takes the Scripture to be saying? Or is it just hermetically sealed off from that kind of evidence?
I absolutely think that scientific observation influences the way that we interpret Scripture. One way to think about it is that, if you think about the major creeds of the Christian faith, none of them make scientific scientific observation statements. You know, we talk a lot about, you know, whether the earth revolves around the sun or the sun revolves around the earth, but that was never in the Apostles' Creed or the Lord's Prayer or any of the things that we took as the statement of faith. And I think it's an important point for Christians to recognize that, you know, all of these questions are not creedal, you know, foundational statements. They're questions about, not even about science, really. They're questions about observation. You know, is this this way or is this this way? I don't think it's, I don't think that's the place of, you know, I don't think that's what religion is about. I don't get that kind of value out of religion in terms of explaining things that, you know, I can't explain.
So I think it comes back to the question of who's God and what is God like, because if you attribute certain properties to the deity, then you're going to end up with inconsistency. But if you just believe in a watchmaker God who set the whole thing rolling, then the whole thing is rolling exactly as science, you know, has a chance of revealing to us. So the problem does come now. I think Tim really, you know, pushed the point well, which is how do you deal with, you know, a book that says this all happened in 7 days and in this order when there's scientific evidence that it took a lot more than 7 days and not in that order, right? Or six if you want to take the day off and not count that. So at that point you're forced back to say, well, day doesn't really mean day, and you know, the birds didn't really come before the fish or whatever it is, right? But you're doing an awful lot of backpedaling at that point and changing the story about what the deity is. Now, the question is what's left at the end of that process, right? So I, you know, some of my best friends who profess to be Christians really have not much of a conception of God beyond whatever it is that sort of is responsible for everything that there is, right? There's not much attribution of any kind of properties of the kind that you would get out of any scriptural description to that. That's a very thin notion of God, and that's a kind of, looking at it historically, seems to be a kind of God in retreat, right? If not quite dead yet, as Nietzsche said, right? At least having less and less sort of direct to say about the things that we find in the world.
Yeah, I mean, ask, so you mentioned that, you know, this change from, you know, viewing that account as, you know, God created the earth in 7 days and so forth to one where, you know, said it. Now, were you then saying that the alternative explanation is that God is a watchmaker then?
And
that
changes? No.
Okay, because you were saying that it changes who God is. And I see that that change is changing what God has done, but not necessarily changing who God is.
That's not going to be a concise point to address, right?
Okay, but you would disagree then. You'd say that it does fundamentally change.
Well, because I think that your conception of who God is has to be wrapped up in what you think God has done, right? What other access do you have to who God is other than what God has done? So if you change your view about what God has done, it seems to me you have to rethink what the nature of this being is. And maybe that's an important piece of rethinking within the theological tradition. And maybe that's part of, as we said before, sort of getting the mythology out of the religion and getting to some more reasoned conception. But the question is, what's left in the face of science explaining more and more of the things that people originally turned to scriptures to explain? Mm-hmm. Right? And this is, you know, it's not just Christianity. So some good friends of mine who are very serious mountaineers, lots of Himalayan experiences. We're describing being up in the Himalayas in Pakistan with a guide, they were absolutely insisting, the Westerners, not to drink out of these streams, and all the guides are saying, oh, this is safe because the Quran tells us that any stream with these properties is safe, right? And the Westerners started trying to explain to them that, no, there are these little invisible things in there that can make you really sick. And the reaction they got was that you folks are just crazy. What, little invisible things, right? But that's a fight that particular interpretation of Islam must lose, right? It seems to me science has to be the authority on what's safe to drink and what's not safe to drink.
There's certainly a natural selection bias against that interpretation.
Yes.
Of course, there are many, certainly within the Christian tradition, there are many theologians, both historical and contemporary, would say the Bible never was making claims to begin with about the nature of the created order.
But yeah, but I mean, I would
famously Saint Augustine in the fifth century AD.
I would say that there certainly is, even taking the view that sort of creation account is meant to be read in a sort of either poetical or allegorical fashion, I think there is still great content in terms of understanding, from that account that God was the creator of the earth and he had certain motivations in doing this, and whether it was a scientific account or just sort of some impressionistic painting of what happened, and because I think there's a sense in which people want to use that account sort of as like fortune telling, God sort of hid a secret there that will then, once you see it, it will really convince you that God, because once we discover it and there was no way the ancients could possibly have known this, so then okay, now I believe, and I think that is fundamentally an incorrect reading of scripture. God doesn't hide things there that are secrets as as like a magic trick to convince us later. He wants us to be convinced by reason and discussion and relationship, not just, okay, well, I overpowered you with my, David Copperfield mojo.
There's an interesting question there, but I'm going to resist. I'm just tempted to start. You can see I'm already starting to insert myself into the conversation. I can't do that, so I'm sure we have another student waiting in the wings, so yes.
Hi, my name is Kelsey, and I have a question for both of you. So for Troy, how do you make sense of miracles as a scientist? And Colin, what do you make of the miracles outlined in the Bible?
So I got asked first. So, I think there is a misconception out there about miracles, which does have to goes back to this mythology idea that miracles exist only to explain things that science can't explain. And I think that's not true. That's not actually what miracles are about. And I can give an example that was a very important thing for me, which is when my son was 3 months old, he was diagnosed with an incurable blood disorder. It was an autoimmune condition. It was causing internal bleeding, and the doctor said, well, we can do palliative care, we can make sure that he lives a long life, but he's always going to have this condition, and we're always going to have to be treating him for it. And then by the time he was one, he no longer had an incurable blood disorder. It was pretty miraculous to take the sort of, the sort of standard phrase for it. And certainly, to me, was a miracle. Now, would I be surprised if there was some mechanism by which that happened? Was there some environmental factor that said, even though it was incurable, something he was exposed to that caused his immune system to reset, or some genetic factor? Entirely possible that there was a solid, mechanistic, scientific explanation. Doesn't make it any less of a miracle, because the meaning of that event for me, of my son being sick and now well, is significant.
Well, first, glad to hear your son.
Yeah, thanks.
Good. And I think, though, we just disagree on the interpretation of the event. So, yes, I would suspect that there's a mechanistic explanation of this. Incurable means we don't know how to cure it in most doctors' mouths, right? Not that there isn't some possible cure. We just, we don't currently have a cure for Ebola, but it doesn't mean that there isn't one out there, right? And, some proportion of the people will recover from it spontaneously and others won't, and the proper naturalistic investigation is then go look at the ones who survive it and try to figure out why they were the lucky ones. Now, each of the people to whom that happened has friends and family who are going to regard it as something of a miracle. But I think this is a very attenuated sense of miracle. And so if we come back to the question that was directed to me, what do I make of the miracles in the Bible? I don't think they're like this, right, on the whole. I mean, maybe we could get into specific passages, but, feeding a huge crowd with just a few loaves of bread and fish, right, if that's the correct description of what happened, I'm more inclined to doubt it. This is mythology. So my one-word answer was, that's how I treat it, mythology.
Okay. I think we have time. Yes, we certainly do, for another question.
So the last question I have for you is, if we can't be certain of either science or religion, why does this conversation even matter?
So,
and finally, is it going to be on the test?
That's the one thing you can't be. No, you can't be certain of that either, right? Well, look, it matters because there are certain... To me, it matters because there are forces in the world, and I'm not saying they're represented on this stage, that is antithetical to science, that in fact gets in the way of allowing us to discover more about the world and engage with it in deeper and deeper ways. Now, I'm not going to tell you that every piece of technology is good or that every scientific question should be pursued, but it strikes me that in the grand scheme of sort of cultural balance of things, religion has been on both sides of the promotion of further human enlightenment, for want of a better term. And it's important then to sort of find who the allies are among the religious and not fight them and unite against the common enemy here, which seems to me to be the superstitious enemies of reason.
Now I'm thinking that I might have misheard the question.
Religion and science, we can't decide.
What's the point, right?
I had my answer. I was like, am I answering the right question?
Yeah, so maybe I missed.
Yeah, yeah. So my answer is that I don't necessarily think that it's religion and science like this, but in terms of making decisions about religion and faith, I think they are important. If you can't make up, you say you can't decide. I would go back to the thing that I mentioned at the beginning, which is I think that you have to decide. When you go out of here, you're going to have to decide if you are Muslim or if you are Christian. Whether or not you're really made up your mind about it, you will decide. Because if you don't pray 5 times a day, you are unlikely to be a Muslim. And if you don't keep kosher, you are unlikely to be Jewish. And if you don't if you don't go to church, you're unlikely to be Christian. There are these either-or propositions to these things. And then there are ways that we approach things like science that are influenced by our faith position. Sometimes, in certain faith traditions, it is harmful to scientific inquiry, and historically there are examples of that. Some faith traditions have been quite nurturing of scientific inquiry. And I think, the decisions here are really about something that you do have to decide, and then trying to figure out how science helps you to adjudicate between the different things that you might decide there.
All right, I think now it's time for me to call Chelsea back to the stage so that she can bring us on home.
Can we just give another hand to our speakers and our moderator?
Thanks, guys.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.